Asian stocks mostly slipped yesterday as America's big tech rally began to stall. And investors braced for a data-rich week, including America's core PCE index and various activity gauges for China. The PCE index also closed down yesterday by a third of 1% to back below 6,900. Joining us for more on the markets now is Mike Enriquez. He is president of Sun Life Investment Management. Hi, Mike. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Mimi.
Hi, Mike. So we're hearing a lot of these big fund managers all over the world just upgrading their view on global stocks to neutral from underweight, some of them going overweight, in fact. Are local fund managers or local investors doing the same? I mean, what's your assessment of this market so far?
Yes, Mimi. I think for Sun Life Investment Management, we've also adjusted our allocation to domestic equities. We were previously at neutral and now we're doing overweight, given the fact that I think there's been a lot of developments. We recognize the fact that number one, valuations continue to be cheap, and I think this is the year where we expect inflation to really fall and, more importantly, interest rates to start adjusting lower.
Okay. And when you look at the index issues, for example, I mean, just the index retesting 6,900, we're up, what, 6-7% so far this year, first 2 months. It's quite tricky, really, for an investor. I'm thinking, do I trim now, take profit off the table, or do I wait? It's still not done going up yet, and I don't want to miss it. So what are you telling your investors? Do they wait? Do they go in full charge ahead? What's the advice? What's the strategy?
I think we've seen a lot of profit taking happening towards nearing 7,000. I think it's just a natural tendency of investors to just lock in some of the gains that for those especially who were able to pick up at lower levels of the index. But I think, as I mentioned, this would probably be the year where we can exceed 7,000. Our own target is just conservative at 7,200 for the year. Admittedly, it's our base case. There's still a lot of upside risk for that valuation, but I think we still need to recognize the fact that as we see short-term interest rates continue to adjust lower, then we would probably see more interest from investors to really enter into the market. But right now, I think it's just normal that we should expect some profit taking, especially for those who entered at lower levels.
All right. Very quickly, we're in the thick of the earnings season, and it's a dead giveaway. Banks did so well because they're headlining, they're leading everyone else when it comes to announcements. And speaking of banks, I wanted to share RCBC hitting record high profits for 2023 full year amid faster than industry loans and CASA. For those who want the breakdown, it's record high, but the growth was actually pretty flat, up just 1% to 12.22 billion for 2023 from 12.1 in 2022. They're citing customer loans soaring 15% faster than industry average, CASA deposits up 19%, outpacing the industry's 3% growth. Total assets of RCBC now at 1.2 trillion. It's the fifth largest private bank in the country. And it's not just RCBC, even China Bank. China Bank also netting 22 billion pesos in profit for 2023, up 15%, translating to an improved return on equity and return on assets of 16 and 1.6%. They ended the year 2023 with 1.5 trillion in assets, up 11%. Net loans were up 10% to 772 billion, deposits up 11% to 1.2 trillion. I guess the question is, do you think the banks, the stellar performance of banks has really overstretched itself? That this is it, this is the peak? Because after this, it's reasonable to expect banks' earnings to start normalizing.
Well, if you dissect the earnings results that you've provided, higher loan growth, higher deposit base. And higher loan growth as well, the banks also enjoyed higher net interest margins together with the higher loan growth. High loan growth is really an indication of confidence in the economy right now, given the fact that a lot of the people, even corporates are starting to take a chance, borrow money coming from the pandemic. And this is really a good sign of confidence on the economy that the economy will continue to grow, and thus they need funding. The second part of the result is higher deposit base. It shows that in spite of that, there's a lot of liquidity in the system. It's just sitting in deposits for the simple reason that deposits, time deposits of banks continue to pay very attractive rates. So once we probably see those start going down, then you'd see investors willing to go back to risk assets, meaning equities. To answer your question on banks, I believe that banks can continue to enjoy stronger net interest margins and stronger loan growth, because if you see rates start going down, a lot more companies, a lot more individuals will be willing to borrow money to expand their business, to buy high ticket items, and the translation of low rates has a lag effect on the banks. They don't adjust it immediately, so they can still enjoy that high net interest margins down the road. So I think it's still the banks for this year.
Oh, wow, still the banks. Okay, we have this just in from the FTSE. I know that institutional investors cover this. Mm-hmm. San Miguel Corporation will no longer be deleted from the FTSE All World and All Cap Index. So that is good mm-hmm. news, right? It means that they continue to be on the radar of the big institutional funds.
Yeah, at least those are some passive rebalancing, but definitely that helps a lot on the index names, because the major flows that we get from markets are index rebalancing on these FTSE or MSCI. For FTSE, it'll happen on March 18, but FTSE is a smaller. There's a smaller following from FTSE compared to MSCI. But nevertheless, I think it helps a lot on liquidity for index names.
All right. And if we could just share, there was a PLDT disclosure at the Philippine Stock Exchange today for those who have been covering the Sky Cable PLDT deal that did not push through. If we could just pull out the graphics, PLDT says they wish to clarify that the parties mutually decided not to proceed with the PLDT's proposed acquisition of the broadband business of Sky Cable due to, they're saying, the non-fulfillment of certain closing conditions, which compelled both parties to revisit the commercial terms of the proposed transaction. Since the parties were unable to agree on the revisions to the commercial terms, they just mutually decided not to proceed with the transaction. Of course, we have been reporting this, PLDT out the picture. It seems like Converge ICT's Dennis Oi could come swooping in like the White Knight. What do you make of this story?
Well, I think either way, the AMC and the Sky Cable definitely is a valuable business. I think that it gives a lot of value to whoever will take it. I think the content is something that definitely either Converge or, well, PLDT could have taken advantage of.
All right. That's why we like you, Mike. You're very nice. But thank you for that. Of course, this is a story we continue to follow. We have shareholders who continue to ask us questions about this. Mm-hmm. So we'll continue to follow developments here. In the meantime, I think we're now ready for your blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us. Just describe and leave your viewers to guess what this is.
Okay, so this still follows the theme of low rates. We're looking at property together with banks. So property is another sector which we think can definitely outperform. And in fact, this particular stock has outperformed the index, I think rising more than 10% over the last few weeks. And speaking of foreign investors, this stock also is a recipient of additional foreign buying. And over the last 2 weeks, we've tracked net foreign buying consistently. And this particular real estate company has businesses on malls, offices and residential. What we like about the residential is now they're entering into the premium residential market with their JVs with Hong Kong Land and the Shangri-La Group. NAV, discount to NAV, continues to be very low, under 60% discount to NAV. Prospects for the stock to continue to move higher, probably north of 10% from the recent jump. In spite of the run-up, we still continue to believe that this will continue to outperform the index for this year. So this is one of the major property developers in the country.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Mike, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Always a pleasure to speak with you. See you soon.
Thank you, Mamie.